Hello, everyone. I'm Valentina Stramiello, Head of Programs at the European Patients Forum. I hope you have enjoyed the DPF Congress so far, and probably you have attended the previous sessions where we have discussed digital health literacy, patient empowerment. In the previous days, we have discussed also access and accessibility. Now we are going to discuss the safety of digital health tools. And that's because we are aware that the digital health tools that are coming to the market need to be safe, and we have to avoid that they don't bring any possible harm to patients and to users in general. So that's going to be the topic for this 1 hour session. I'm going now to give the floor to Rosanna Tarricone, who's Associate Dean at SDA Bocconi School of Management and Associate Professor in Public Administration at Bocconi University in Milan, Italy. Rosanna is going to present, give us an overview on actually the medical devices regulation, how it can also inform HTA at European level, and give a very first glance on how the market is evolving on digital health and specifically on mobile health. And now I leave the floor to Rosanna for her presentation. Thank you.
Because that's a very great opportunity also to bring in the discussion, the perspective of economics and health economists. But let's start with a couple of premises. First of all, I mean, we have seen an exponential growth in the number of medical apps, especially because of the COVID pandemic, although we have to admit that even before the COVID pandemic, there were already no important signals that mobile health was at the doorstep of an increasing trend. However, what is really relevant is that many of these applications are seldom acknowledged even today as healthcare technologies. Another important premise is that medical apps, mobile health apps, are often developed and introduced by players who are completely different from, you know, the usual suspects. You know, I mean, the pharmaceutical companies or medtech companies, which means that these new players seldom know how the process of assessment of health technologies work. And this is another important item that we need to bear in mind when we will discuss, you know, the assessment procedures and the processes for these new technologies. Another important element that, you know, needed to be, is the increasing investment that the European Parliament and the European Union has decided to grant to the member states because of COVID, the EU Next Generation, the most important recovery plan that we, you know, we have in mind, you know, in recent decades, and the EU Next Generation is going to focus specifically on digital health, which means that in the next few years, we will foresee an even more rapid increase in the development and introduction in the market of these technologies. Another important element is also the new regulation of medical device that, as we all know, has been officially implemented last May of this year. And even more importantly, we are now waiting for the official introduction and introduction of the new EU regulation for health technology assessment. It's, I mean, we know that this will happen by the end of this year, and we are all looking forward to this great opportunity. or at least, I mean, I think this is a great opportunity. Before going into the, central question of this presentation, I would like to share with you some facts and figures on the mobile health market. You know, just for all of us to have an idea of how much big, you know, this market has become and is becoming and will become in the next few years. So, I mean, if we look at this data and the projections till 2025, we can see that, you know, the market size was of around 53 billion US dollars a couple of years ago, but it is estimated to grow to over 300 billion US dollars before the end of 2025. And I mean, these forecasts have been done before the pandemic. Another data relevant data on the market of mobile health apps is, you know, the one that shows the increase that is around 80% of increase of medical apps between the first quarter of 2015 and the fourth quarter of 2020, when the pandemic was already a reality, unfortunately. And be aware that these data are concerning only medical apps. So we are excluding from here, you know, health and fitness apps. If we wanted to focus to a subset of medical apps, you know, the ones that are called digital therapeutics, also in this case, we can see that the market worldwide is increasing tremendously. And here the growth rate is around 400%. Digital therapeutics are particularly important for our purpose because, as you know, the name says, we are in front of true therapeutics, you know, true therapeutic options for our patients, and these are the ones that, you know, are compared to many other apps will need to be assessed in a very, in a very effective way by the MDR and by the HTA in the future. And indeed, if we keep focusing our attention to to those apps that have as a focus the management of diseases, well, in this graph we can see that among the health condition management apps, the largest category is a focus on chronic conditions. This is another element that I think needed to attract our attention. Although it is true that the booming of mobile health has happened during the COVID pandemic, it is also true that the greatest percentage of mobile health apps have been developed and introduced into the market to manage chronic conditions. We all know how much relevant chronic conditions are for the health of our populations. And besides COVID pandemic, the true pandemic we are facing since decades ago is the pandemic of chronic diseases. So mobile health apps are more than welcome in this market since they can really represent a viable solution for treating these patients. And here we go to the promise of mobile health apps. So what are really the promise of these new technologies? Mobile health apps may be particularly effective in self-management, which is intended as an individual's ability to manage the symptoms, the treatment, the physical and psychosocial consequences, and also lifestyle changes that are inherent with a chronic disease. But more importantly, mobile health apps can improve patients' empowerment, which is the process of gaining knowledge of oneself and, importantly, the ability and the motivation to influence, oneself. Health. Mobile health apps can also make healthcare services delivery more efficient and financially sustainable in the long run. And this is of particular interest for European countries, since we know that in this part of the globe, the greater proportion of healthcare systems are publicly funded, more or less. I mean, there are differences across the jurisdictions, but by and large, we could say that in European countries, the prevalent model of care is a kind of universal care coverage. So we also know that this type of healthcare system is threatened by financial sustainability, also because of the presence of chronic diseases whose prevalence and incidence are increasing alarmingly. So the promise of using mobile health technologies to keep the healthcare systems, in their original public, public mode, is an important promise we really would like to foresee. So, are we there? I mean, are these promises really true? I mean, can we feel happy with the state of the art? Well, the findings that we have as of today are not so enthusiastic. The impact of mobile health apps on health outcomes for chronic diseases remains still unclear, and the results of the findings are rather mixed. There are already several systematic reviews and several meta-analyses that indeed show mixed findings and mixed impact of apps on clinical outcomes such as self-management and behavioral change. And this inconclusive evidence base of mobile health apps can be attributed to the poor adoption of a formal development standard, but also to the methodological quality of study designs. But that said, where are we in the European Union with the assessment of digital health solutions? The impact of the new medical device regulation on digital health has been explained through the guidance on qualification and classification of software that has clearly highlighted a two-step process of indeed qualification and classification. So, as for qualification, the European framework points the points the interest around the medical device software, which is defined as a software intended to be used alone or in combination for a purpose as specified in the definition of a medical device in the MDR or in the future next year for the in vitro device regulation, regardless of whether the software is independent or driving or influencing the use of a device. So basically, this definition excludes those software that are not considered medical devices. For instance, those that have a library functions. As for classification, the introduction of rule number 11 has clarified that we need to categorize the medical device software according to the significance of the information that is provided by the device to the healthcare decision, so something that we can call the patient management, in combination with the healthcare situation, what we can call the patient condition. So we can see at the right side of the slide, the categories that can come out from the combination of these two criteria. And needless to say that, the most severe here and the more critical, you know, the situation of patient management and patient condition, and you know, the highest the risk profile of the medical device software. It is important, I mean, to note that these rationale, these logic goes hand in hand with the traditional pattern of the medical device regulation in the European Union, but also in other jurisdictions, that basically links, you know, the quality and quantity of clinical evidence with the level of risk of medical devices, and in this case, of medical device software. Moving to the clinical evaluation, the medical device regulation brings a lot of attention to the adoption of processes that can be iterative, so, you know, continuous process to be embedded in a kind of a, you know, total quality management of, you know, product assessment. And the guidance provides a set of methodological principles for the generation of clinical evidence, such as, I mean, these evidence should in a way respect the following principles of a valid clinical association, the technical performance, and the clinical performance. So basically, in order to be granted a CE mark, the manufacturers need to develop clinical evidence that will be assessed in terms of safety, effectiveness, and performance. And with the exception of class one devices that can still be self-certified with a notified body, other mobile medical apps, for example, the digital therapeutics, will have to do the clinical work and will need to submit a clinical evaluation report in order to get the market access according to the criteria that I just listed. What we can foresee in the near future is an increasing interest from the regulatory bodies for developing a strong and robust clinical evidence from the manufacturer's end. And this is something that I do think will also be stressed with the new European regulation for HTA that, you know, as I said, is awaited by the end of this year, and I presume will definitely help contribute to elevate the evidential requirements for mobile health applications. I mean, more in general for any type of health technologies, but given the focus of this panel this morning, we are here talking about mobile health apps, especially because, I mean, the following question will be how can we reimburse and how can we remunerate, you know, the usage of mobile health apps, you know, from the end user's perspective. Such as healthcare professionals and indeed patients. Very, very briefly, I mentioned to you that thanks to this European grant, we had the opportunity of going inside the assessment frameworks currently available in Europe, but also in other jurisdictions. And thanks to this comparative analysis, we have concluded that we have identified some recommendations that we do believe can improve the process of assessment of mobile health applications for the sake of safety and effectiveness. I'm not going to read and comment all of these 10 recommendations. I really would like to bring your attention only to two or three of these. For instance, as I said in the premise, mobile health applications have have promised that, you know, patients can, you know, can improve their empowerment, can improve the self-management, which means that compared to other types of technologies, namely, you know, pharmaceuticals or the more traditional medical devices, we are facing new technologies that can add additional health outcomes, you know, compared to the traditional ones. But however, these health outcomes needed to be measured, which means that the new metrics needed to be developed. And, you know, this is an area of research that I believe needed to be further developed. Another important element that we believe should inform, you know, the future research and the future debates and discussions around the assessment of mobile health solutions is, you know, the types of clinical studies that need to be used in order to address safety, performance, and effectiveness of mobile health applications. From our systematic reviews, it was clear that very traditional RCTs are still used to assess the clinical performance of technologies that, according to our opinion, are not really suitable for traditional RCTs. More innovative study designs like adaptive trials and many others that are already available should be used and should be implemented and should be suggested to the manufacturers in order to gather appropriate clinical evidence. And finally, you know, organizational assessment. Another important element of mobile health applications is the potential to integrate different settings of care and different specialties. Something that, to be very honest, we were dreaming already decades ago. I mean, we have been talking about integrated care even, you know, before the booming of mobile health apps and digital solutions, but we never got there, honestly speaking. We do believe that thanks to these technologies, this reality can become truer and can become, you know, faster. However, this means that this element should become relevant and should become important when the assessment of these technologies is done. And that's really, you know, the final point, cost and economic evaluation. The evaluation of cost and the economic impacts of medical apps should require no innovative economic instruments. The ones that we already have are more than sufficient. However, I think that we need to develop new metrics for measuring the outcomes, as I already said, but also new metrics for measuring the costs, especially if we really want to be broad enough to include also the organizational impact of mobile health apps. So let's go to the concluding remarks. The iterative nature of software development makes it unsuitable for a linear conventional assessment approach, and we need to reverse these pre and post-market assessment phases with a circular approach that, you know, should cover the entire life cycle of these technologies, which also means that we also need to think in a very different way when a clinical evidence is generated for the assessment of these apps. I do believe that the upcoming regulation on HTA is a great opportunity to make regulation and assessment as a part of a innovative assessment chain. For instance, when the new governance of the HTA regulation will be in place with the HTA coordination group, I do believe that This coordination group should work very closely with the medical device coordination group in order to develop a multidimensional life cycle assessment approach to assess mobile health apps. And as I said, even more in general for medical devices. I do also believe that the opportunity is great with the expert panels to make early dialogues between different stakeholders, including especially the patient's representative. Specific elements characterize the assessment process of mobile health apps and, you know, for instance, equity, non-conventional outcomes, study types of clinical studies and economic tools. And these items, I think, should be further developed if we really want to take, you know, the opportunity that the MDR and the HTA regulation is providing us with. And that's the conclusion of my presentation, and I do thank you for your attention. Thank you very much.
Welcome back, everyone. So now we have a panel discussion starting, and I have the honor to introduce you to our esteemed panelists, including Flora Giorgio. Flora is a pharmacist by training, and she is heading the team of health technology assessment at the European Commission in DG Santé for the unit medical devices and health technology assessment. We have on board also Papatia Alkanjenka, who's an expert. She's been working in academia for nearly 20 years, but at the same time, she has been devoting her time and focus to on disability groups and activism. As a person with spina bifida, she's involved in the Turkish Spina Bifida Association, and she sits on the board of directors of the International Federation for Spina Bifida and Hydrocephalus. We have also on board Oliver Bisazza, who's Director General for Industrial Policy at MedTech Europe, the European Trade Association for the Medical Technology Industry, including diagnostics, medical devices, and digital health. And we have the honor to have back with us Rosanna Taricone, who I have introduced earlier during before her speech. So I would like to quickly start with the first round of questions, and I would start with Oliver, as the focus of the presentation from Rosanna was largely on the market of medical apps. So my first question to you, Oliver, is just a consideration that industry, and here I want to include both large companies, small, medium enterprises, and startups, play a key role in ensuring safety for digital health solutions. And I wanted to ask you, which measures have you put in place to facilitate the safety data collection in a context where there will be an increased demand for this data? The floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Valentina. And just first of all, I would like to say I echo a lot of what Rosanna's presentation said at the beginning. Like many other technological innovations, digital innovations have the tremendous opportunity when used in healthcare to deliver improved patient outcomes, better manage the aging population, meet the demand for services of healthcare systems, mitigate shortages, reduce costs, etc. And those digital therapeutics and mHealth apps that Rosanna talked about are one important example of this, but they are not the only one. You know, when we talk about digital health solutions, a lot of the really exciting stuff is actually happening inside hospital IT systems, inside conventional medical devices, and some of them even in the cloud, you know. And when we talk about the safety and trustworthiness of these particular solutions, my impression is that the most imminent focus of the European Commission right now is on the very specific element of AI, artificial intelligence, where there is a proposal for a new AI Act, which will really dive into how to strike the right balance in assuring the safety and trustworthiness of these. But to answer your question and to step a little bit back, I mean, whenever a digital health solution meets the definition of a medical device, it's automatically in a highly regulated space. Europe has new medical device regulations since 2017, and they actually comprise some of the most substantial safety requirements in the world. And all of the requirements that are applicable must be met before these solutions are placed on the market. And one of the many ways that safety has been strengthened with these regulations is actually in the post-market space. And so, you know, when these solutions are placed on the market, the manufacturer must conduct comprehensive post-market surveillance checks throughout the life cycle. The manufacturer must not just sit back and wait for feedback, like negative feedback. They must proactively seek it out from patients, from users, from the healthcare system. And that's one of the reasons why, for instance, users of these solutions, who might be patients in some cases, they are now given in the manuals a specific notice telling them how they can report serious incidents to the manufacturer and the member state competent authority, so that that safety experience is really collected and feeds back in. The final thing I would say to answer your question is not just about the safety data collection itself. That is a clear regulatory obligation, and it's been strengthened. But the regulations that we have now are also trying to make patients and the wider public more aware of what this data are. So there is meant to be more transparency about devices and the evidence underpinning them. So when we have the future tools like the European Database on Medical Devices, patients, public, healthcare professionals will also be able to access some of this safety data that has been collected. So one thing to look out for, if it's not already on the radar of patients, is the summary of safety and clinical performance documents, which will exist for all the high-risk devices like implants. And it will need to be continuously updated so that as this safety data you mentioned comes in, you have at least once a year or so, an updated snapshot about what the true safety experience is of the device. It's clinical performance too, but certainly the safety. And that should be something that is a powerful tool for patients, healthcare professionals, and interested citizens to consult.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Oliver. And I will now give the floor to Papatia. Actually, I wanted to understand from you what are the issues that you have identified so far when it comes to safety of digital health solutions. We know that safety for patients is a kind of concern when it comes to medical devices in general and digital health solutions as well.
Thank you, Valentina, and thank you for providing me with this platform to speak about it. I would like to, if you like, start with a very general description of what spina bifida is, because it is related to the kind of issues that we have identified. Spina bifida is a neural tube defect in which the baby's spine and spinal cord does not develop properly in the womb. So it results in a wide range of orthopedic, neurological, and other related medical problems. And many people with spina bifida also develop a condition called hydrocephalus, which means a buildup of fluid in the brain. Since spina bifida and hydrocephalus present on a wide spectrum, and of course, spina bifida or hydrocephalus is not the only condition with a spectrum, digital health solutions may not meet the needs of everyone on the same level. So there's definitely a need for a more tailored design for digital health solutions instead of a one-size-fits-all approach. And sometimes this is not really met as far as we can see. User friendliness is also an issue. Not everyone has similar or equal digital literacy, for example. And when you have technology and remote monitoring, then you have people monitoring their own conditions, so they should be able to read or interpret the data. However, people come from different socio-technological technical backgrounds, so they may be fairly digitally literate, but they may need more training with using the digital health solutions. And last but not least, the information available about digital health solutions is sometimes wrong, misleading, or even absent. the discourse around digital health solutions and their media representations can be problematic. They are sometimes scary, for example. I mean, I think there was an episode of Homeland where the pacemaker of the vice president was hacked and he just was killed. So it just creates this negative, scary sort of representation. And sometimes they are a little bit too idealized, so people have unrealistic expectations. So I would say, to sum it up, we need tailored solutions, user friendliness, and there is problematic information sometimes, which are the key issues in digital health solutions, as far as I can see.
Thank you, Papatia. I mean, I'd like to further comment on this point, because it comes up that digital health literacy and user friendliness are not just important in terms of accessibility, but also in terms of safety, because at the moment, the patient is the one self-managing the condition and directly using the digital health technology. Then also for safety issues, they have to be able to use and understand the tool that they are actually using. That's quite key, I think. And now I would like to move to Flora. And this was slightly mentioned by Rosanna already during her presentation, but I would like to hear from you. What do you think about the medical devices regulation framework? How you think it can support and improve evidence collection to inform HTA? You can unmute yourself, Flora.
Yes, thanks a lot, Valentina. Thank you for inviting me actually as well to be in this panel. I just, on your question, and also make some comments on what was said so far. I mean, I think Oliver somehow already hinted how the medical device regulation contributed and let's say enhanced the body of evidence needed for reassuring also what you know patient and professional and healthcare system at large, because as it was said, I mean definitely the digital solution have a major potential for healthcare system. But I think it's also true from what also we heard from Rosanna, that it's important also that it's not only the communication correct, but the type of evidence are solid enough to justify then the decision on, wider uptake in healthcare system, which are necessary to help address the challenges that we are all know about chronic condition and self-management and solution that can help the patient to be more empowered and better deal with the condition are definitely one of the response that we should put in place. And I think Oliver's also hinted, and that's definitely also in the objective of the commission as at large. So the MDR is one element. We have the HTA regulation, which again will possibly strengthen this second part in terms of how you can provide to the payers, the decision makers, additional evidence requirement, which would help them to take this informed decision, which type of device would be more useful for their own healthcare system and for managing certain condition. But, you know, there is also the broader initiative of European health data space, which again, we are looking at different element on how we can facilitate flow of data, which is another component in this digital solution. So now, I mean, to come back to your question, I think that the MDR regulation definitely is one step in that direction. And, you know, the safety requirement and the performance requirement are more scrutinized than it was in the past. So we believe this is a major, important element. Oliver mentioned the post-launch monitoring activities, which again is particularly relevant for this type of solution, as you said, that have to be used, not all, but many are actually used directly by patient. And then I think that connects a bit with the HTA regulation as well, because this type of data and as well, the scrutiny and the cooperation that will happen also between HTA bodies at European level through the regulation on HTA will help also member states to be a bit more, if I could say, trained, aware, and consistent on how you have to assess this type of solution, which require a very different type of assessment to medicines or a normal another type of medical device. And that's where we see the potential of also the, let's say, the I shouldn't say the interaction, but, you know, the building up on the different steps. MDR set the major safety and performance requirement. And then you have, with HTA regulation, in certain cases, and I mean, we also have to be pragmatic. It's not all devices, not all digital devices. For a medical device, the scope of what we call joint assessment is rather limited. But the major, let's say, contribution, I think, will come from the direct, from the regulation on HTA, will be bringing the methodological work on how you assess digital technology. And then that by bringing the HTA bodies together to work together on how, which type of methodological approach you will do for the assessment, will also strengthen, in our view, what Rosanna was saying, addressing a bit what the problem that Rosanna identified, you know, the type of evidence also to support this uptake of digital devices are not always so conclusive. And I think by giving from the assessor some more guidance, I think it's a bit of a chicken and an egg, a circle type of evidence, which is the way we believe digital technology have to be assessed probably.
So it will be more a circular iterative approach, as it was mentioned by Rosanna.
Yeah, indeed. I think that's a bit the key. And I think one is really coming together between the assessor and that's, we believe, especially on methodological challenge, because this is where, you know, we need to make sure that this type of device, when assessed, because they need to, when assessed from the HTA perspective, the assessor have this in mind and the specific methodology needed and all the points that were made earlier by several colleagues. And this, in our view, will also somehow address this issue of the communication with which that Papatia was referring to. I mean, once you have solid evidence, when you are more, let's say, confident as healthcare system on which type of device you could invest in, I think that's, you know, it has a spillover effect. And you know, one point, and sorry, and then I'll close that. It's important to realize, you know, HTA is an add-on to the basic requirement, that the devices that are on the market are safe and are performant. The point is that HTA is looking at, you know, for my healthcare system, what is, you know, where do I put the money in? Let's put it this way. And European level, we don't go so far, obviously, but a strong assessment of the comparative evidence, it's what we are trying to, you know, what the new regulation will bring in the system.
Thanks a lot, Flora. So actually, you have already replied to my following question. So I will go next with Oliver again. And so we have been talking about safety data collection earlier. How do you feel this will contribute to benefit HTA? Because we know for companies, of course, when it comes to HTA, it can be perceived as a burdensome when it comes to providing data to HTA bodies. Do you feel that the effort you will be doing already in the marketing surveillance phase will already inform HTA? You can unmute yourself. Yes.
Sorry, I lost the end of your question there, but I think it's how much do you see the link, right, between the safety data collection and
how
the
it will inform HTA? Yes.
So, well, to be very frank, we do not see a huge role for informing HTA from what comes out of the medical devices regulations, because we see them as completely separate worlds. You know, you have the regulatory assessment of safety and performance, as Flor has said, that might be Mars, and HTA is really Venus, I have to be honest with you. Now, if HTA has a clear purpose and is done in the right way, it could be enormously valuable to help Europe assess and evaluate the value of digital health technologies and compare one digital health technology to another. As Flora said, potentially inform the decisions of payers, reimbursers, etc. But for us, all of that is about the clinical effectiveness. It's about how helpful or useful, as Flora said, these solutions are. We see that as a fundamentally different thing from safety. Safety is, in our minds, the complete realm of safety regulations like MDR and IVDR. Now, it's said in the new EU regulation on HTA and confirmed many times from the Commission that there should not be any interference between these two. But on the other hand, it's also clear that some of the promoters of HTA and the EU HTA regulation itself, it also talks about doing assessments, joint clinical assessments on the safety of medical devices. As I said, data will be generated, captured, reported from the real world experience, including safety data. More of this will be made transparently available, and the EU regulation on HTA will require some of these regulatory information to be considered for when future European assessments are done. But we very much hope that the future work on HTA, whether it's at European level, national level, or regional level, will not in any way repeat or duplicate the safety assessments we have under the MDR and IVDR. For the simple reason that it's more than 10 years now, Europe is working on medical devices regulations. Mm-hmm. They were negotiated, they were published. We are nearly 5 years into their transition. And as I said, they represent some of the most substantial safety rules in the world for medical devices. So if we really believe in them and we trust them and we promote them like everyone says they are, then we should, you know, be confident that the regulatory approval of medical devices going forward is robust and not repeat or constantly question that when the time comes to do an HTA. So I hope that answers your question. The safety data will be actually one of the inputs for HTA, but we very much hope that HTA will be done only in those cases where it can add value, and that is to compare the clinical effectiveness and performance of products, not look at safety once again.
Any immediate reaction from Flora or Rosanna? Or you want to go on?
I can just maybe reiterate what I said earlier. Indeed, these are two regulatory frameworks which have different remit and objective, but I wouldn't say them like Mars and Venus, but I would say them are both in the same, you know, they are both aiming at supporting and enabling uptake of innovative technology, and digital is a major, you know, major component on this objective. Of course, there are different requirements set. And as I said earlier, and Oliver confirmed, the safety is assessed at the MDR level. What HTA does is doesn't reassess the safety, is compare what you have and what, you know, compare between different things, compare between, you know, this device and this other device, and may look also at safety data in the comparison, but it doesn't reassess. That's definitely, you know, that's a very, very important point for us. I mean, we are, and now we have even in the same unit, the HTA and the medical device regulation, it's all a commission, it's a EU, you know, it's a EU legal framework. We cannot afford to have two legal frameworks that either contradict or create duplication. It's a very similar way what happens on the pharma side. I mean, the HTA is a step after that, but however, we see that there are some quite a lot of contribution that enhanced requirement on the clinical effectiveness of the MDRs as set will actually support this this is the final objective of increasing the uptake, because at the end this is the final objective, increasing the uptake. And if we see that the evidence maybe are not enough for the HTA bodies, it would be in the best interest of patient and healthcare system that those evidence are made more available and maybe more visible and are stronger for the, you know, to facilitate this uptake.
Thank you, Flora. And I will give now the floor to Rosanna for a quick reaction.
Yes, thank you very much, Valentina. Yes, I would like to echo what Flora has already said. Perhaps, in my perspective, I would be even a bit, stronger on this point. I do believe that the assessment of health technologies, and I'm now talking in general, then I mean I will go specifically to digital health, should go, should consider a continuum process. So having in mind that the regulatory process is something completely different from the HTA process, in my perspective, is not the right way forward. We should, although there are different objectives to be attained and different evidential requirements, but the two processes should be seen as a continuum. More specifically for digital health, why? Because the life cycle of these technologies is even shorter than the life cycle of medical devices. There are medical apps that have new versions after a few weeks since they're entering the market. So it would be, beneficial for the industry, for the patients, and for all other stakeholders, if the regulatory process and the HTA process can start together by agreeing and by having a kind of convergence on the types of evidence and the types of studies that would be needed by the manufacturer to be developed. So for the industry to save time and to save money.
Thank you, Rosanna. Thank you all for contributing to this insightful conversation about this specific point. I would like now to hear from Papatia about what do you think about digital health solution and their contribution to improve quality of life of patients. Do you think they may play a role? This has come up also in the previous sessions, but I wanted to get your specific perspective.
I would probably have not thought about digital health technologies or solutions if not for the pandemic. But the COVID-19 pandemic has shown that there would come a time, and there came a time, where you would not have access, face-to-face access to your GP or face-to-face access to health services in general. So it was really an anxiety-ridden period for me because I need constant monitoring and I was unable to access that service. And I think if I had a digital platform where these things could be monitored properly, that would have helped me a lot. And also the other thing I think is for a lot of patients with long-term conditions, continuity of data and having access to that data is important. For spina bifida specifically, we transit from pediatric care to adult care, but there is usually loss of data when you move from pediatric care to adult care. So access to my health data has become a problem. And I think digital health technologies would prove to be beneficial at this point, especially when you move from one country to the other. Again, specifically in my condition, I moved from Turkey to the UK, but I have no access to my data when I moved to different health systems, different countries. So I think there's definitely potential there, and there's definitely need for such technologies.
Indeed, transitioning from pediatric care to adult care is a topic we have focused a lot as EPF also in the past. And somehow it's also a lot about the logistics and how the information can travel while the patient is transferred from the pediatric to the adult care. And this is not yet solved. So we really hope digital health can support us in this process. I would now continue with you, Papatia. And I would like to ask you, how can patients and patient organizations contribute to ensure safety of digital health solutions when these access a wider public? As patients, you are often in the forefront, and maybe you can play a role before these tools go and are accessible to a wider public. What's your take on this?
I think I have a couple of points to make here. The first one is patient organizations have access to data about the actual lived experience of patients, which is really important. And it means that they're in the position to inform and affect change if they communicate and collaborate meaningfully with the industry or with the research and development departments. That is one issue. The other is patient organizations may play a crucial role in ensuring proper patient safety standards are embedded in digital health technology, so they can help with that as well. And they can serve as hubs to train service users, train them and teach them how to manage their own conditions and have shared accountability. I think there's a lot of potential to tap when it comes to patient organizations and patients.
Thank you. And then the next question to Flora. We have had the UNETA joint actions working till very recently, and I wanted to hear from you whether you can share any example from UNETA on joint assessment focused on digital health solutions, and if you have any examples to share around the COVID-19 solutions eventually, and if there were any methodological issues identified by HTA bodies in that context.
Thank you, Valentina. Just also a comment on what was just said. I think on the specific UNETA element, what I can say is that, I mean, beside the UNETA, what we found very much during the negotiation on the health technology assessment regulation, there was a lot of interest by member states on, assessing digital solution. And there was I spare you the detail, but there was a long discussion on what should be in the scope of the regulation. And, digital solution were really pointed as, this is the future. We really need to work together on those. At the end, on their medical device article, it will be some of the solution that will be eventually selected by the coordination group. So, just to confirm that there is an interest in this, that there is an interest from the assessor in working together on this solution, because are the solution of the future, because of all the discussion we have been having so far, because of all the opportunity that can bring to patient care and healthcare system, but also because they have a very different life cycle than medicines and other type of device. So this very fast developing phase, the continuous update, which requires a different mindset as well from the HTA side. And that's where we see really the opportunity that the HTA regulation brings in there. The other point I wanted to make, following up on what Papatia said, and then I come back on the specific example of UNETA, is also that, Papatia outlined all the input that a patient organization could have also in the development of the solution, but we also, through the HTA regulation, give an important role to the patient expert and eventually patient organization in different way to their input in the joint assessment process. So when you do a comparative assessment at European level, we have in the regulation established the principle that patients have to be consulted, included in the scoping phase of the assessment in the process. And I think that's an important element I wanted to raise, because it is recognizing, and I mean, it's not that it has to be recognized, but I mean, it is hoping of improving the output of the joint assessment, because the input of patient in the selection of the endpoints, quality of life, they are really enhance and facilitate and improve the output of the joint assessment. So that was also wanted to refer to. On the specific example from UNETA on the digital assessment, I have to say that I did a bit of homework. There were not specific joint assessment in this area so far. Also because in UNETA, the focus, I have to say, especially in the beginning of the year, has been on pharmaceuticals, and because also of all these challenges that we were mentioning. So UNETA is in their activity, they have mainly done a lot of work in sharing challenges and try bilaterally or multilaterally to find solution to those. So, and on the COVID-19, a similar approach, I have to say, because in the COVID-19 emergency, what we had agreed with the UNETA that actually in the last year of the Joint Action 3, they basically almost stopped to do joint assessment because all the HTA bodies were completely overwhelmed by requests by national authority to assess and to give advice. And what found, what came out to be extremely helpful in UNETA is to really, between the national agents, to share real life, you know, assessment and what they have done, how they have solved certain issue, because the COVID-19 was, you can a bit compare to some of the digital solution. And the start of the emergency, there were no evidence or very little evidence. So it's very challenging to give evidence-based recommendation based on very little evidence. And that's what has shown also even more how important is actually to create this network of HTA bodies that could actually share the experience and jointly assess some, I mean, address some of the common challenge. What they did, and this is available on their website, they had some rolling review or a number of products which were assessed, let's say, in and monitored their efficiency in terms of comparative effectiveness when, you know, a bit following the example of what EMA did. So these were the two main activities they did, both in the COVID and I think can be a bit translated to the digital world.
Thank you, Flora. And one last question to Oliver. If you have identified any standing challenges that need still to be addressed, or if you think that on your side as an industry representative, everything is in order.
No. We are never in a state of perfection, unfortunately. I mean, the new regulations on medical devices are very important, absolutely supported. And as I said, many years of work has gone into them, but we are not yet there in terms of delivering all their benefits, for sure. I mean, just to give you the one example I mentioned of making that safety data transparent and available to the world, it relies on a European database to be built. And that is still a few years off, unfortunately, but work continues in earnest on it. I also have to tell you that although the regulations have been with us for nearly 5 years right now, due to the very long time it took for Europe to build the regulatory infrastructure, fairly few devices so far have gone through those regulations and been assessed according to the new rules. It is now ticking up very much, including this year. And so I very much encourage Rosanna and others, if they continue their assessment of these solutions, to look at the new generation of digital health solutions that have been assessed according to today's new rules. Because until just a couple of years ago, most of those digital health solutions you found on the market were probably only in accordance with the old directives from the 1990s. It's really in the last months that we are now seeing a major transition of digital health solutions to the medical devices regulations. So that's good that it's happening now. Now we need to look very honestly about whether everyone's expectations are being met.
So thank you, Oliver. And now I would like to give the floor to Rosanna. We have a question from the floor about any concepts of mature circular regulatory models for health apps. Do you know whether there are such regulatory models available, Rosanna?
I am aware of what is happening in different jurisdictions, both you know, US, but also some European countries. And at the best of my knowledge, I'm not aware of any mature, as I mean, the question says, any mature circular process so far. But I can tell you that there are jurisdictions that are piloting some very interesting processes. For instance, in US, there is this process, this pilot, which is called the pre-certification program, where basically the FDA, instead of assessing the single digital solutions, they aim at assessing the company, the manufacturer, which is quite interesting as an approach. And we are all looking forward to see what happens at the end of this pilot. But in Europe, Germany is perhaps the most advanced country in the assessment of digital solutions, namely medical apps. And perhaps this is a circular process because they have also linked the final stage with a decision on reimbursement of specific apps on the DiGA directory. So these are, you know, perhaps the first, I mean, the first two, perhaps they are not mature, but, you know, interesting processes that I am aware of, and we need to look at them in the future.
Thank you, Rosanna. We have a very few minutes left and no other questions from the audience, I guess. So I would like to really take this last minute to ask your really takeaway messages, your, if you want to share anything before we close the session. Papatia, the floor is yours.
Thank you. I think the most significant thing I would like to share is the patient and patient organizations should be part of the process in every single way, because there is a great potential that is usually untapped. It is there. It is there to be used. Use it.
Thank you, Papatia. Flora?
Yeah, just to reiterate what Oliver Rader said, digital solutions are great and are an opportunity for the future. They are safe, they are performant, but we really think there are opportunity to increase further their uptake and their contribution to patient care and healthcare system by having maybe better and more sustainable, you know, comparative evidence to available to everybody so that they can really be uptake.
Thank you, Flora. Oliver?
Just like any other form of innovation, digital health innovation presents the challenge of opportunity on the one hand and managing the uncertainties on the other. And regulation is one way to manage that and not let anything in. But believe me, Europe does not lack for regulation compared to many other parts of the world. So I think our challenge is to make sure our regulations are consistent, balanced, clear, that we do not have a lack of them. So let's have smart regulation, not more.
Thank you all. And so hope to continue the conversations in the chat and be active in our platform, because we have a lot of material to be shared and there is an opportunity to further discuss all of these arguments. Thanks a lot for your participation.